thank you for that very flattering account of me. It's a great pleasure and a great privilege to come here and speak to you, and particularly because you've chosen the theme, the classical tradition. And really that's, I think, the reason I'm here, because that's what we're all interested in. I think probably before we get going, it's maybe a bit elementary, but it's just useful to remind ourselves of the definition of the word classical and the definition of the word tradition. The Oxford Dictionary says of classical, I've written it up here so you don't forget it, conforming to the rules of Greek and Latin antiquity. And the definition of tradition, handing down from one generation to another. So, what we're doing, as you intimated just now, is highly counter-cultural. Here we are in the most advanced country in the world. I've travelled thousands of miles to get here, and our interest is building well today. And rather than studying computers and all the exciting things that this world has produced, we put that on one side and we concentrate on rules which were given over 2,000 years ago. You would say, at least many people would say, we must be out of our mind to go back when everything about our age is trying to go forward. But that, I think, is really what the classical tradition is all about. And I'm very happy with that as our mission statement today. The rules of Greek and Latin antiquity are, as defined, I think is a fine definition. I would just wish to extend it in two directions. And there may be some controversy about this, but I think it goes with the package. And first is that the rules of Greek and Latin antiquity assumed the sort of buildings that were being built in Greece and Rome at that time, which was load-bearing masonry construction. They put their buildings together, nearly all of them stone. The jointing was lime mortar, not cement, and brickwork, again, in lime mortar. And the walls were thick, and because that was the construction they used, the buildings lasted for millennia. And you have to look at the Pantheon, which I shall be showing you in a few moments. That's a brick building with thick walls bonded together in lime mortar. Now, this may be obvious to many of you architects, but I gather some students and lay people here, but the real problem with the modern architecture is that it uses these other materials, which have their uses undoubtedly, but in building for longevity, they have short life. I'm thinking of steel and glass and reinforced concrete and plastic. And all those materials have a coefficient of thermal expansion, which is two or three times the coefficient of expansion on brickwork, lime mortar, and stone. So that every time the sun comes out, a piece of steel expands, as we know, and when it freezes, it shrinks. And this happens not only seasonally, but also daily. And because there is this high coefficient of expansion, we have to put expansion joints about 15-foot centres. Whatever the centres may be, we have to put expansion joints in all modern buildings. And the expansion joint is covered up with a neoprene gasket, which breaks down under ultraviolet light. And sooner or later, the moisture and the rain penetrate the building. And that is why a recent US report on the useful life of steel and glass buildings has been put at 25 years. They may last longer, but their useful life is 25 years. And I've seen the same happen in London, buildings going up, and 15, 20 years later, it seems to be a good site to build another building, pull it down and put up another one. But what people don't think about is the phenomenal cost of pulling a building down and putting it up again, maybe higher next time, but also the environmental cost as well, which people are more and more concerned about. So environmentally, as well as financially, it's wise to use the same materials that were used in antiquity so that when we build, our buildings will last at least for centuries, which I think is a huge difference, which people generally are not aware of. They think they have a very short time span. I gather builders in China just think 25 years, that's good. It would made its profit, washed its face, as they say, financially, and then put up another one. But they don't think that there can be times of adversity as well as prosperity. And in adversity, what's the good of a building where you can't see out of the windows because double glazing is all misted up? You can't afford to service the lifts or the air conditioning. Give me any time a solid masonry building which will continue for hundreds of years. And if you're passing your buildings on to your family, you don't want to find that they've got to rebuild the building from scratch. So I think we're not just talking about style, we're talking about permanence and longevity. So that's how I would extend the definition just in that way, excuse me. Secondly, the rules of Greek and Latin antiquity originated in much earlier civilizations than Greece and Rome. I should be talking, and many of our speakers, I'm sure, will be talking about the orders, the Doric, Ionic, and Corinthian orders. Vitruvius said that those orders originated in Greece, in the regions of Ionia, Doria, and Corinth. But in fact, those orders are much more antique. We don't just go back, we go much further. And one of the characteristics of classical architecture and why I love it so much is that one's always looking back to what people did before. So not some brilliant idea in my head, but some much better idea, which is in the head of people who knew more about building than I do. And there are thousands of them, and we can learn from them. When you go to Rome, you see Renaissance buildings, and you think, where do they get those ideas from? Well, we know that the Renaissance, as its word describes, Renaissance, got their ideas from Rome 1,500 years earlier. Where do the Romans get their ideas from? Well, the Romans got their ideas from the nation they conquered, Greece, which is fine, that's what Vitruvius thought. But it goes on. Where do the Greeks get their ideas from? The Persians, the nation they conquered. And I had a job in Persia for many years, and I've been to Persepolis, and you can see to this day enormous stone columns with flutes and entices and elaborate bases and most intricate capitals. Wouldn't quite say they're Doric, Ionic, or Corinthian, but they've got animal heads and other shapes. So there was a tradition of building that classical detail, with its Doric, Ionic, and Corinthian, in the Persian world, long before Greece. Where did the Persians get their ideas from? They got them from the nation they conquered, Babylon. Remember Nebuchadnezzar and the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. So that's the nation which they, the Persians, found out and used, used for their architecture. Where did the Babylonians get their ideas from? Well, we know that in 589 BC, Nebuchadnezzar came up and conquered Jerusalem. And he took away the Temple of Solomon, which was supposed to be the greatest monument of the ancient world. He took away the parts of it whether they were Doric, Ionic, and Corinthian, you can imagine, I have no idea. But he brought back that the beautiful ornaments from that ancient civilization to Babylon. So he took it from the Temple of Solomon. We might say at this point, where did Solomon get his ideas from? Well, we know that Solomon was the wisest man that ever lived and very rich, but it was his son David who planned it, and David got his ideas, as all the Jews at that time would have done, from the tabernacle in the wilderness. Now, the tabernacle in the wilderness is described in Exodus accurately, and it was given to Moses by God, and he recorded it in the book of Exodus. And what I've done with my, I had a, somewhere I had a, I don't know, I had a piece of something to mark. That's it, thank you. There we are, thank you. I've drawn it on the board just to show you, because actually, I've studied this book, a description in Exodus, many times, and there's an awful lot that isn't an architectural description, but it does give you the plan dimensions. It gives you the outer court, and it gives you the little temple, the tabernacle in the middle. And this is pure, purely conjectural supposition. There's no detail, there's no elevations, there's no sections. But we do know that there was a sophisticated building which had columns round the outside, and those columns, it's reasonable to assume, would have been very simple, a simple structure, somewhat like just a square abacus upon a pole which was held up by guy ropes. Inside was the tabernacle, which had five columns, it's recorded there, at the front of it, and that separated the holy place from the Holy of Holies, which had four columns. Now, we don't know what it looked like, and many people have made reconstructions, and reconstructions, from my view, are, I'll tell you more about the architect who did the reconstruction than the building itself. I think we're all guilty of putting our own ideas into what we read, but it wouldn't have been unreasonable if you're thinking of the ornament on the top of the capital at the entrance to the tabernacle, if there was some reminder of the purpose of the building, which was to bring a ram in sacrifice for the sins of the person who brought it. So that if there were some ram's horn pattern on the top of that capital, it would have been highly appropriate. Now, I'm not saying that that is the origin of the Ionic order, but it's much more likely to be true than Vitruvius's account of the Greeks inventing it. Similarly, there was this Holy of Holies, which very few people saw, because only the high priest went in once a year into that space. But we do know that it was highly ornamental. We know it was timber and gilded, and there were special artists, Bezalel and Aholiab, who did the wreathed and cunning work for it. So that whatever it looked like, there was this original building way back before the Greeks and Romans, which probably, and certainly in my view, I don't think it's just faith, I think it's probably fact, built up a picture that these orders are actually divinely inspired. Now, to say the orders are divinely inspired is quite a strong statement, and I don't think everybody accepts it by any means. But Raymond Erith, who mentioned a little earlier, who really taught me everything I know, because I didn't learn anything at the architectural school, as you can imagine. 7 years, completely wasted. But he was about the last classicist, and I had to say to him, look, I know nothing. And he said, well, I know that. And he then began to teach me about architecture. He died in 73, and I've been carrying on what he's taught me ever since. Now, he was not a man of any Christian conviction at all. He was never went to church. He was just outside church things. He wasn't a complete atheist. I think he would acknowledge that God had made the world. Who wouldn't? It's so perfectly designed. But he said to me, not long before he died, he said, I've worked in the Doric, Ionic and classical orders all my life, and they're so beautifully proportioned, and they seem to work so well one with another. And the whole detailing and the way architrave, frieze and cornice work together, impost, archivolt, all those parts. He said it's far too brilliant a system to have been made up by man. He said, my own feeling is that the orders are divinely inspired. He said, actually, I don't say that to many people because they think I'm a nutter, but that is what he believed. And I think it's useful, particularly in a conference like this, to stretch this definition, conforming to rules. That's absolutely right. We're here to conform. We're interested in rules. We're not like the modernists who just want to ignore the rules. But we want to know what the rules are, and the rules are given in antiquity. We don't have them absolutely tied down. We don't say the Doric order's got to be 8 diameters high, as Palladio said. But we know the proportions roughly, and as we use them, and particularly as we get older and older, the more we use them, the more we enjoy them, and the more we see that they have a system which is thoroughly worthwhile. Now, to say the orders are divinely inspired is really no more than saying that classical music is divinely inspired. We have the octave, A, B, C, D, E, F, G. H becomes the octave above or the octave below. And that whole system then is taken up by the great musicians who take it as read that you have the octave and you work with the proportions that it's given. And so in that sense, it's not so unusual to say that something that has been used, the orders that have been used for what we know is 2,000 years, actually goes on much further back into history. Well, that's my first point, really, definition. I now move on to discernment, just for some people who like each point to begin with the same letter. We're moving on to discernment. And keep thinking of the orders as we begin to discern what good buildings are. Now, I have to confess that having been 5.5 years at the Architects Association and didn't know what to look for, that when I went to Rome in my first year at the Architects Association, there I was in Rome with 1 or 2 friends. We didn't know what to look for. No one was there to tell us what was a good building or a bad building. I don't think we even knew the difference between Renaissance and Roman. We'd heard of Michelangelo, but we've never heard of Vignola or Scamozzi or Sansovino or San Gallo or Palladio or Longhena or any other great masters, let alone the English masters like Gibbs and Hawksmoor and Vanbrugh. We were taught, as many of you who've been to architectural school, to forget everything in history and just start now and do something new and exciting. So it was a great help to me at that time to join Raymond Erith, and it was really through him that I learned how to look at buildings. One of my worries about a classical revival in England or America is that sometimes it's not very scholarly and sometimes it's not very well done. I think that every time there is a revival in anything, and architecture particularly, that one has to be a bit patient because people are learning, and as they're learning, some of their works are pretty amateur. We have to know this. But the fact that we may be a bit amateur doesn't mean to say we shouldn't do it. We should enjoy it and get better at it. But my hope is that people will have a high standard in what they appreciate and what they look at and learn from various buildings and see how outstanding architects would handle such details, like how balustrade joins a pedestal at the bottom of a column. Those sort of things need to be in our mind. It's been done many times before, but we're really here to learn from the masters before us how to do this sort of work. And I think that I would encourage every young architect to draw and draw and draw. If you haven't got a sketchbook, go out and buy one immediately. And not just a loose leaf sketchbook, but a proper bound one, and an HB pencil and a rubber, and go out and draw what you see. It doesn't matter terribly to start with whether it's a building which is top draw or not, because the whole process of drawing is where you learn. I sometimes lead a group of friends, about 20 of us, and we go to Venice or Rome, and some of them aren't architects at all, some of them are lawyers and all sorts of people, but they love these sort of holidays because I sit them down in front of a building and tell them to draw what they see. And what I find is that if you can sit, of course it's nice in Rome or Venice, but I'm sure there's places in England and America or internally, it doesn't really make much difference. But the whole process of drawing is something which we must be doing constantly. Obviously, I'm thinking of somewhere like Venice, get into a nice square, find a place to sit, coffee bar, where you haven't got people behind you so they're not looking over your shoulder, and make sure the sun is not in your eyes, because then it's very hard to draw, so you want the sun behind you. And you want a good building in front of you. So there's quite a few details you need to get right. And then sit there from after breakfast until lunch, looking at the building. And as you look at it, before you start putting any pencil to paper, just notice that there are columns and how widely spaced the columns are, whether the columns are wider in the middle and closer at the end. And there's three orders, perhaps it's Doric, Ionic, or it might be Ionic, Corinthian, composite. And how it works, and where there are arches, and just before you draw, just speak to yourself about what you're looking at, and then you get your pencil out and you start doing all that to try and get the drawing on the sheet of paper. And I've done this many years, and one of our friends, Larry Berder, is here. He comes with me too. And some people like just to hold out the sketchbook, and then they can see what they're drawing, and then put it down, and just keep trying to get what they see onto that piece of paper. Some people say, oh, but I can take a photograph. Well, a photograph is the worst thing you can possibly do because it stops you thinking. And in the 4 hours what you're drawing, that is while the process of what you're seeing put on the piece of paper enables you to begin to see how this building works. And I must have filled over 30, 40 sketchbooks with sketches of these buildings. And of course, it marks it indelibly in your mind. You never forget that building. And you then begin to understand what the game is that that particular architect did. And then, who knows, years go by, you find you've got an opportunity. Oh yes, I remember we did that building which had a very large overhanging pediment, and this building is calling for the same sort of thing. And you can go back to your library and pick it out, and it's part of your repertoire for learning how to build well. I could give you an example just to encourage you to do this, and I would encourage you all to draw, because we're all born with some ability. Obviously, some people are outstanding at drawing, and there are many examples to see here. And there are many people who earn their livelihood from drawing. I don't. I really try to record, but I also enjoy the process. But I mean, there's few things more beautiful than, for instance, an Ionic capital, just the mere fact of the Ionic capital. And it has as you can, as I'm drawing here, something like this. You can see the, what we call the abacus, which runs across the top, and then it would have the volute of the Ionic capital, which runs here. This is a Roman Ionic, and that is just that process of drawing what you see. It runs across here, and then there'll be this what's called the echinus, which runs back underneath, and then the return of the Ionic. What's so nice about the Roman Ionic is it isn't just four corners like that, but it actually has a bolster at the end, so it goes, it returns like you have a sort of baluster return, and then this comes round and then goes down on the column. And just to sit there in the sun on an afternoon is a pleasant experience, and it also teaches you to look at it. Now, the Ionic order, as most of you know, the Palladian Ionic order, has on top of it an architrave, frieze and cornice. I know that to some of this I'm teaching my grandmother to suck eggs, but I'm just telling you that. And the other thing to do is, as you're looking at it, and the more you know, the better, easier it is, but on top of it is architrave, frieze and cornice, and here they are, and it's quite good just to work out what is going on in the architrave, frieze and cornice. For instance, the architrave has a cyma reversa and a plate, and then another cyma reversa or a bead, and then a bead at the bottom. And if you know that, draw it in section. We also know that Palladio tended to make his entablatures in the proportion of four for the architrave, three for the frieze, and five for the cornice. It's not an invariable rule, but it's a useful rule of thumb. So you have you have the frieze. This could be a pulvinated frieze, and then you have so there's the frieze, and then the bed molds of the cornice, which is over cavetto and overlo, then a modillion on the more interesting ones. It had a little, so you've got a modillion running here, and then on top of the modillion, the corona, which runs up here, and a top cyma. So that is your cornice and your frieze and your architrave, and that's in the proportion of 4 to 3 to 5. And it helps to know that, because as you're drawing it, you may find that some of the lines are a bit close and you need to sort of raise them or fall them. And then if you take it out, if you run these lines like this, so you're seeing it as it were from the sheet where you're looking, you can draw these mouldings on the return. So you've got your architrave running here, and then the culminated frieze, which is quite popular, and then on the return you've got the cavetto. I don't know, half of you can't see this, can you? But still, then there's an overlo, and then you have these modillions. And these modillions have a little bed mold on top of them. They run back like that. Then they come back, and you have another modillion. It's typical example of, you can see that, actually, you can see plenty of them in this city as well. And between that, and then there's the corona that runs along here, you can then see between that is a coffer. And in that coffer is usually some sort of rosette. Then the corona overhangs here, and then the top cyma. So that is the what you're really looking at. Runs away here, and then there'll be another modillion in that position, and a overlo in the corner. Well, having got that on your piece of paper, your sketchbook, and you've sort of begun to see how the various parts work together, look also, and give yourself all the time in the world, because you don't want to be in a hurry, but just look also at how these mouldings are enriched on an important building. Enrichment is really for the rich, I mean the people who can afford it, but also on more grandeur. So on a on a cyma reversa, you would have typically a little leaf which is carved into the geometrical shape. So, and it's called leaf and tongue. So this little pattern would enhance the shape. I mean, the purpose of enrichment is to enhance the shape. And this being a cyma is really an overlow and then a cavetto. So it's terribly simple. That's a cyma recta. The cyma reversa is like at the top here. It's a cavetto followed by an overlow. And really, those are all you've got to think about, because you've got the cavetto here, you've got the overlow there, and you've got the two of them, the cyma there. And between that, you've just got the horizontal, which are beads. So it's not that difficult, but some people get frightened about it because they don't quite understand it, because people haven't explained it to them, how beautiful it is. And this, of course, goes back well before Greece. So you have that. You have the same treatment in this moulding here. Cavettos are not easy to enrich because it's already carved out. But the overlow is very well seen. That you frequently see the egg and tongue, which is an egg with a tongue or a dart between. And then you get another one running up like this. And then you get these enrichment inside. So look at the perspective, look at the enrichments, and also look at the shadows, because historically our forefathers looked at buildings and saw how the sun cast shadows on the building during the course of the day. In fact, if you stay there for 4 hours, you can see the shape moving around. And quite often what I do is in the afternoon I go to a different site. Then the next day, if I haven't finished the drawing, I come back to the same place. Sun's in the same place, and then you can sort of put the shadows in. But when you put the shadows on, bear in mind that the sun is coming. It casts hard and soft shadows, so that this overlow here on that would carve quite a hard shadow here. This, if this was in the sun, this would be going into shade. So there's a sort of soft shadow along that side. These shadows would come round here. This is the abacus. It's in shadow. All that's in shadow. This goes into shadow as well. But this is in sun, and this one goes round like that. Similarly, the cavetto, the lower part of the palpinated frieze, would be out of the sun. And here in the cornice, you get a hard shadow on the top of the cornice there, but then this begins to go into shadow again. So it's a soft shadow as it just turns away gradually. And as you look at that, you can begin to see why these mouldings are piled up one on top of another and why in a particular order, because it's all done from looking at this detail. And of course here, although technically all this would be in shadow because this corona sticks forward, you see the shadows like that. So all that's in shadow. But the front part of the modillion comes right forward. And the whole reason for that, architecturally, is although this is all in shadow, the little modillion, the little bit you see there, picks up the shape. So that as you look at it, you're going to see all this dark, but the modillion's coming through until you get right to the bottom. And a lot of buildings, and you'll see some pictures of them in a moment, where you see the light at the top on the corona, and then this little light going on all the way along on the modillion. So it just helps to show you what's going on. And actually, particularly in England, when the light is so dim, you get a lot of shadows or return shadows in here, and you can see all this detail. It's not as if it's wasted, but it's a question of how strong the light and the dark is. So that is my third D, which is drawing. And I think now what I'll do is show you some pictures. So you'll have definition, discernment, drawings, and designing. And when I show these pictures, really they follow the same process. There's a building that one admires, or I admire, and I draw it. And having drawn it, the opportunity comes to use it again. So if you'd like to put the pictures up, we'll have the first one. Where better to start than at the Parthenon in Athens, which I think many of you have seen. Next slide. Next. Now, it's important to draw what you see, and this really gives you the various parts. It's also important to know the names and why they're there. Again, I'm probably teaching my grandmother to suck eggs, but just remember the words, because as you're drawing, you've got the column, Greek stoulos, that's style, that's from which we get style. Then you get that round piece on the top of it, on top of the flutes, that comes from the Greek word echinus, which means hedgehog. And on top of that, a square abacus, Greek, which is table. So that gives you the Doric order that you see on the Parthenon. Then on top of that is the architrave. We've just been talking about that. Arche is great in Greek. Trabs is Latin for beam. So that's the great beam, the architrave. And then on top of that is the frieze with its triglyphs and metope. Triglyph, triglyph, triglyphos, three grooves, and the metope between. Then above that is the cornice. This one has mutules, not modillions, as I showed just now. And then there's the corona and the overlay at the top, and then the top cyma of the pediment. So those are the parts which one draws. And if you've assimilated that, and you've got it in your sketchbook, lo and behold, the opportunity arrives when a client comes and says, I want a building which, well, particularly I want, had, next slide, where in Downing College, which has a history of Greek Revival buildings. So what you've learnt from years of drawing is then immediately useful to pick together. Next, please. Then we move on to the, well, sort of moving historically. In principle, I want to move from Doric to Ionic to Corinthian, just so there's some sort of formation to what I'm saying. That is St. Mark's, and you can see that's not a Greek Doric, it's a Roman Doric, a column 8 diameters high, and on top of that is an architrave, frieze, and cornice next. And there is the detail that Scamozzi was the architect. And you can see the architrave, you can see the top of the column, the capital, with eggs and tongues. And then the archivolt, that's the curved part underneath, with a lion's head on the keystone. And as I say, it's not a very good drawing, it's one I did, but just draw, because whoever you are, that's how you learn, as you begin to put pen to paper to what you see. And sure enough, I'll show you an example of it next. At a house in Ireland, which I finished last year. I have some more photographs to show you in a moment. But there is the same ingredients that really we've seen before. Actually, the lion's head is somewhat more ornamental, and it has a modillion cornice. There are differences, but the things that one has learnt in drawing and looking are what one does. Come in next, please. Another example. I mean, I'm really just reeling off examples of the Doric order. That's the Prince's Queen Mother Square. The Prince of Wales is actually one of the great supporters of classicism in England. And he's not helped because the RIBA have taken away the right of the Prince's School to give a degree. He's remarkably patient. And very consistent, and likes classical architecture. So it's an honour and privilege to work for him on these doors. But that's a colonnade in the square. There's another picture of the same colonnade with, there you've got arches and pilasters, between them. Next. And that's another example of the same. Next. Now, moving from Doric back one, really, to Tuscan, I haven't talked about the Tuscan order. My view is the Tuscan is a simplified Doric. Some people have other theories about it, but that's how it's usually presented. And I don't think there are five orders. I think there are three, but this is just simpler. But that's Inigo Jones, a lovely building in London. And that was really the basis. I mean, you can't always use your examples perfectly. Next. For the infirmary at the Royal Hospital. But again, it is a Tuscan order the thing about the Tuscan, the Palladian Tuscan, has a very, very long projecting modillion. Not quite, I'm moving rather fast. This is another example of the same. It's some almshouses we built near us in Essex. Again, a central Doric order, a Tuscan order with the overhanging cornice and pediment. Next. You can see there. And again, those modillions, you see how they pick up the sun, because the other mouldings, the bed moulds, are somewhat put away in the shade, but you get this centrepiece with six columns and a big Tuscan pediment, and really a very plain building otherwise. It's an old people's building. And it seemed to us that the Tuscan order suits people who actually need the help of the state. You've got the veterans at Royal Hospital Chelsea. These are old people. The next slide. That's a crib for the next slide. That's Villa Papa Giulio. You can see again a Tuscan order with a very enriched arch between. Next. And this is Jimmy's wing at Tedworth, which is for wounded soldiers who've come back from Afghanistan. And it was felt that they needed some, it's a big old house, but this was part of their accommodation, which made them feel that at least they were valued by the country rather than putting in some sort of health centre. Next, please. So we move from the Doric to the Ionic. There is the, I suppose, the seminal work, the Erechtheion at Athens, the Greek Ionic. And actually, the Ionic capital, particularly the Greek Ionic capital, is incredibly beautiful. Next. It's a drawing of it by my son Francis. He likes to draw those sort of details. And you can see the volute and how it goes round and all the ornaments underneath. Next. There's a view looking up of the same. You can see what I was talking about earlier, the bolster and the volute. Next. And there, in the front of Hanover Lodge, which is opposite the American ambassador's residence in Regent's Park. Next. And there it is, and you can see here, it's got this front and also two little Doric lodges as well. Next. Moving from Greek Ionic to Roman Ionic, that's Palladio, the Basilica in Vicenza. You get an Ionic order. You can see there how the modillions really show. And then you have a minor Ionic order supporting the impost and archivolt between. And really, I think that Palladio is my sort of probably top architect. He seemed to understand it in a simple way and write about it. And his book, The Quattro Libri, is essential reading for anyone, really, who takes classical architecture seriously. Next. That's just a drawing I did of it. And again, you can see that front view, which I talked about, and the side view. And it's the combination of the two, which is so beautiful. Next. Just an example, and once a house in England. Again, you can see how the modillions pick up the light. That's a house, again, in Regent's Park, the Ionic Villa. Next. Yes, well, that's Baker Street, and there you can see exactly, I mean, it's a good example of how the shadows hide everything except that modillion. And the great minds that designed these mouldings were always thinking of how to pick up the rays of the sun. Not just that, also to weather, because it's throwing the water off the building. That's part of the purpose of these horizontal lines across the building, that the water doesn't run down the face of the building. So it has a practical purpose as well, but also architectural next. There it is in the middle of a block next in Baker Street, which shows you the length of that's the sort of main entrance to the office building next. Nearer here, Williamsburg. You don't have to make them all in stone, although there's caps of stone, but the entablature is actually in moulded brickwork, which is quite tricky, actually. It's probably more difficult to do it in stone, but it's fun to do, and you get you can see the base of the column, and that's the group of buildings at Colonial Williamsburg next. That's just an example of how it isn't just major buildings, but small houses. This is just a small house in the country, next. And it just gives some sort of value to that centrepiece. A lot of people have seen that photograph of that book. A lot of my ordinary clients say that actually that's the sort of house they'd like to live in. And you know, I think a lot of what one's doing is just pleasing your customer. If they like a simple house with an Ionic entrance, that gives them what they're looking for, a really simple load-bearing masonry structure. Well, they're all load-bearing masonry structures, but with a window in the middle. Next. There's one not so far from here. Again, an Ionic order, somewhat larger, what we call a giant order. Next. That's the Corinthian. Just as before we come to the Corinthian, one of the things I learned from Raymond Erith was that every person is one of the three orders. And he would quite often come back from a client and say, you know, she was Doric, and so was he. And we must definitely give them a Doric house. The last one I showed you was the client was definitely Ionic. When I did Downing Street, had one of the rooms which Mrs. Thatcher had, and Mrs. Thatcher is definitely Corinthian. So I think I could probably say to most of you, if I've talked to you for 5 minutes, which order you fit into. So you must remember that you are one of the three orders, and it's important when you marry, hopefully, to marry someone who's the same order as yourself. That is the Pantheon, and really that is the one of the wonders of the world. And there it is, 2,000 years old, load-bearing masonry, brick, and still there. And those columns, amazingly, they're about 6 foot in diameter, huge scale. Next slide. Well, when I was a Rome scholar, it was scaffolded. And can you go back to the last picture? When I was a Rome scholar, it was scaffolded, and you can, I haven't got a pointer, but you can see at the side, there's a little door that comes out at the back, at the top. And I managed to get out of that door, I got permission from the Comune di Roma, and climb along and up the pediment, and then over the top to measure that cornice. Next slide. And that is the measurement, my drawing of the measurements of it. And you can see me in the corner, and you can see how big the eggs are in the egg and tongue. Over 6 foot high cornice. We, you know, whoever we are now, even, you know, great rich countries, we don't build cornices in that size. It just shows the vision and the determination of the Romans to be able to put together buildings on that scale. Next. There's a Renaissance example, Palladio, San Giorgio. And as you look at it, you realize that, I've sketched this many times, you realize that there's a composite order. Composite Corinthian, almost the same really, but there's a composite order on a pedestal. Then you see at the sides there's a smaller Corinthian order, and then at the either side of that there's another Corinthian order, and inside, if you go in, there's about 10 different Corinthian orders. And it's only by having your sketchbook with you that you begin to notice all these things. Otherwise you just say, isn't it beautiful, take the next photograph. But when you analyze these and when you sit and look at them, then you really learn. Next. That's a drawing of it. You've got the capital, composite capital with a swag between the next one, and these composite medallions, which are very different, and then running up into the pediment. Next. That's another example. That's actually an uncut one, which Palladio did on Villa Giorgio in stone. Next. That's another building not so far from here, Corinthian order. Next. Next. That's Downing College, Corinthian. Actually, there you've got a composite order in the centre and a Corinthian at the side. I mean, it's really very straightforward. It's just got the pedestal in the Palladian proportions with a column, which is 10 diameters high, and then the entablature at the top, which is another 2 diameters. And really the architectural purpose of it is to use the little features like the rustication and the spacing of the columns to make it interesting. Next. Yes, there's a front view. We haven't talked about Baroque, but you notice that door in the middle. It's part of the trouble about sketching is that another thing Aerith used to say to me is that book looks sketchbooky, or a building. An architect may be full when he's done lots of sketches, hasn't had many clients, and a poor client comes along and he finds he's got every sketchbook worked out onto his design. And I was getting very interested in Baroque architecture and what Longhena did, and you may know the door in San Giorgio, which has that door with a pediment which is cut in like that. And as this was a sort of theatre, we felt it possibly appropriate. So although you've got the orders, you've still got varying, 1,000 different ways of expressing them, and Baroque is one of them. Next. And of course, Quattrofontani Borromini, he was a master at Baroque, and you can see there he uses a serpentine front. I sometimes think, and as I get older I think I learn more, that the Baroque really took off when people have got a bit bored doing straight lines. And I think when you've been doing this sort of thing, as I have, for over 50 years, you think, well, do I have to do another Doric order which is absolutely straight? Couldn't I put some sort of curvature onto the building? There's all sorts of theories of how Baroque architecture started and whether it was really debased, but I think it's really that people who are doing it just think of other ways of doing it because it makes it more interesting. Next. And there's a drawing of it. Again, if you see it and like it, measure it, get your sketchbook out and measure tape, so at least you've got the details, as I did there, which is very useful when I designed the Corinthian Villa next at Regent's Park, which has this serpentine front, and then with it you have these unusual capitals and then spirally fluted columns, and it gets more and more Baroque and more interesting. Next. You see those capitals, they do all the sort of things in the opposite direction, which is what one learns by studying architects like Borromini and Bernini. Next. Now that is in Krakow. And that Habsburg Empire architecture is very interesting, really. There's I had a client recently, and we were discussing how if the Grand Tour had gone through Czechoslovakia and Prague and Krakow, a lot of the examples that were used on English buildings in the 18th century would have been very different. And I said, you know, if you'd rather, we could not just have an ordinary Doric thing. I've done hundreds of them before, but we could do something more Baroque. He said, yes, that's what I'd like, next. And, well, that's the drawing of it. That's the actual building in Krakow. It's such a help to have spent half a day drawing it, because then when you have to do the working drawings, it's somewhat easier next. There's a house in Sussex recently finished, which has this door front next, and another one with this shell and swags running and broken pediment and volutes and little scrolls at the side, all a sort of detail that you won't find in Palladio's book. But it's also part of the classical tradition. And I think it's important that we don't just keep doing the same thing, but we vary it on according to each job next. Well, that's Richmond Riverside, which is about 15 separate buildings. And I've hitherto been talking about the Doric, Ionic and Corinthian orders as if the order is one order for each building. But I now want to, towards the end, I want to show you examples where you have more than one order. In fact, you can have all three orders on one building. Next. And their familiar territory, the Colosseum. You've got a Doric with a superimposed Ionic and a superimposed Corinthian and superimposed Corinthian stroke composite. It's quite a sophisticated, in fact, a very sophisticated building. And all the games mathematically that you have to work out where the triglyphs and metopes fit into the frieze on the lower order, then you have to work out that it gives you the right spacing for the medallions on the Ionic order above, and then you want the medallions on the Corinthian order, which are closer because the scale is smaller, and of course the building is reducing in height. So that does really show whether you know how to manage not just one order, but three orders together. Next. There's Palladio's great example. Goethe said if he had to say one building, choose the best building he'd ever seen, he said that the Convento della Carità in Venice was his choice. It's a very consummate example of how Palladio handles the three orders. I mean, this is really S-level stuff. You've got the Doric, and then you all the medallions, and all the things you look for in their proper order and the reducing in the right proportion. Next. Well, I was frustrated. I couldn't get all three, so this was at Richmond Riverside. We had the Doric and the Ionic, but again, it's a pleasure to use the two orders together. Next. And this is actually not yet built. It's starting in about 3 months' time. This is the other side of Queen Mother Square at Panbury, where you've got a Corinthian building on a pedestal, and then on the at the corner, where the Queen Mother's statue is going to be put, is you get the three orders, Doric, Ionic, and Corinthian. Next. Other examples, less, well, somewhat sort of simpler, slightly more like McKim, Mead and White, where you have a rusticated base and then a giant Ionic with a superimposed giant Corinthian. Next. See the same detail and the type of detail. And then, of course, when you want the greater height, of course, you've got bronze windows with two heights of windows in one height of column. Next. This is a building which has the three orders. It's the new Brentwood Cathedral. Doric on the outside. Next. And inside, it's actually got a Tuscan order between the Doric. You've got the Doric at the corners and the arches with the Tuscan. Next. And then an Ionic, can't really see it, but at the axis is an Ionic. Pick next. You can see, yes, you can see the Ionic there at the side door, the side window. Next. And then a Corinthian order on the organ. Next. You've got again all the parts we were talking about in my sketch. You've got the leaf, you've got the dentils, you've got the overlay, you've got the coffers, you've got the rustication and the rosettes, as well as the carving on the leaves. Next. Downing Street, well, three rooms needed to be completely, well, they were wholly neglected, bits of them were there, but that has a Doric order, new Doric order, on the central room, in the three state rooms. So you've got Doric in the middle with a new ceiling, which is takes up all the enrichments. Next. Ionic in the pillared room, a new Ionic overmantel. Next. And the Corinthian, which was Mrs. Thatcher's favourite room. And there's the Corinthian order in the corner, rather similar to the Corinthian villa. Next. And just a few, oh yes, this is another house where the three orders are used. There's Corinthian on the outside, that's a fern in Dorset Fern Park. Next. There it is from a distance on the other side. Next. You can see the Ionic order to the entrance. Next. And the hall inside, which is Doric. So it's quite nice to have the three orders in one house, just to give the sort of variety. Next. This is my last house I'm showing you. This is a house, can you go back? That's a house in Ireland, near Kilkenny. Wonderful opportunity. Ireland's such a beautiful country, and this client wanted everything to look Irish. Next. It's got a very pronounced mutular Doric order in Irish, it isn't granite, it's Ballinasloe slow limestone with a buff colour. It doesn't show on these pictures, but the contrast in colour is quite important, with the softness and the greyness of the columns. So we've got a Doric order on the outside. Next. There you can see more of the detail, the mutules, the triglyphs, the gutty. There's more detail, the columns looking up into the detail. And just go back a bit, that cornerstone, we call a cornerstone, in masonry construction, that stone, it's on the end, on the slope, it's also leaning out. It has to be a massive stone. Actually, that stone, the one at the top, weighed over 20 tons when it was being lifted up. And you need those. And why it's interesting to me is that when you go around the Colosseum, not Colosseum, in the various parts of ancient Rome, in the ruins of it, you can see these very big stones, and they're nearly always the cornerstones because they have to stay in that position. Next. And a carved cartouche. That sort of detail. It was an opportunity to do things properly. Next. It's got a big, that's only just moved in, so it's hardly furnished, but it's got an elliptical dome. Next, Ionic, see, Ionic order, with an ellipsoidal dome with coffers going round. Next. And then the Corinthian order to one of the rooms. You can see there the same detail going round. Next. I don't know if many of you go to Ireland, but the Irish in the beginning, about 1800, were very, very interested in ornamental ceilings. And Francini was a great stuccadore, and he came from Bavaria. And they are very unique. And this Irish client felt it was most important to have that Irish character. So we went trotting off to Bavaria to measure ceilings. My son made a great speciality of these sort of details. Next. And these are the sort of drawings that we did. Next. More detail on how to put it together. Next. And then you can see the whole ceiling, and there's various birds worked into the ceiling. Next. And then a couple of ho-ho birds fighting over an eel. So all that's the sort of detail which I think particularly in a gathering like this is important, because You know, there are people here who are involved in plaster work, and people involved in painting, and ironwork, and stonework, and it's bringing all these trades together. And although we would do a drawing of a ho-ho bird, part of it is actually working with the man who's actually making the ornament. And that's really what makes our job so interesting. So I say, you know, as we said at the beginning, have fun, enjoy your job, do something you enjoy like that, and you'll enjoy working. I think that's really all I have to say. And I'll try or attempt to answer any questions. Thank you.